ANDE EMILIO for ES News. I'm here with Michael Bentt, who just had a very compelling story revealed on Netflix in a docuseries called Losers or Loser.
Losers.
Yep, there we go. And the story was super compelling, man. I had to share it with everyone, my immediate family, fighters I know. I work at a boxing gym. I'm also a coach there, and I fight as well. So it was just a compelling story, especially for somebody like me who dabbles in the arts as well. I've been acting also, doing music, etc. So for me, it was something like, wow, this guy did it at the most elite level. You were a champ, and you're also successful in all these other facets of life. How hard was it to be so transparent with your story in front of a large audience, you know, the whole entire demographic that Netflix carries?
Not hard at all. All of us want a platform to tell our story, right? And I'm a performer, I'm an actor. So like, you know, being an actor and a performer, like, you know, it was easy to lay down and get comfortable and not ask for permission to be comfortable. You know what I mean? So like, you know, that's the most important thing, not asking permission to be comfortable. I'm comfortable with my own skin, man. Like what I gotta say, great. If you don't like it, okay, so what?
What advice would you give to a fighter or anyone on transparency? How to be truly yourself in a world where society kind of dictates who we are to a degree, at least. You know, you walk around with this mask, per se, that, you know, people kind of expect you to be someone, and maybe
it's
you're
a
not.
Mask.
Yeah.
Right. You get it, man. It's a mask completely.
Yeah.
But, like, it's a mask that's valuable to the fighter. The fighter's a warrior, right?
Yeah.
And without that mask of invincibility, nothing sells.
Mm.
You know, the fighter himself doesn't believe it. If he doesn't believe it, well, like, nothing sells. But I don't think, like, you know, I don't think boxing at large is really for those kind of truths, man.
Wow.
You know, those kind of truths typically comes after your career's ended.
Yeah. It seems like a reoccurring thought. Mike Tyson, you see him throwing the belt collect dust.
That's right.
They're not what was meaningful to him in life. And the same goes with your story. And it's the telltale story for a lot of champions. How does somebody avoid that same roadblock?
No, it's inevitable.
Okay, it's inevitable. Okay.
It's like, you know, I wish I had the answer for
Yeah.
You know, and if I had the answer, I would tell you. But like, you know, that's part of the the rub or the rub, or that's part of the mystery, man. Because you have to plummet. After you rise, you gotta plummet. And the only way to, like, you know, to reach some kind of success. It's not about success, man. It's about fulfillment, like self-fulfillment. You know what I'm saying? I'm not liking, I'm not worried about liking or pleasing the guy over there or the guy over there. Like, you know, I'm about pleasing myself, you know, and being fulfilled and being honest with myself and fulfilling my own destiny, be it like in the yard, so whatever. You know, but you can't rise. You can't, like, you know, break through anything if you haven't fallen.
Mm.
So, like, you know, failure sucks. This is a great lesson.
Absolutely. Which brings me to my next question. How being so transparent, well, one of the painstakingly tragic moments of that episode that you're featured in is when you describe having a gun in your mouth and actually contemplating suicide. That's something that you were just completely transparent with, that I'm sure just touched so many people that have been in those exact moments, looking at themselves in the mirror, being at the rock bottom of life, you know, like the proverbial end. How do you keep yourself, like, for someone out there who's in that same kind of place, how do they get out of that? Like, I know there's not a concrete answer to that, but how do you fall and get back up again with that, you know, champion attitude?
For me, I've been super duper lucky. Champion attitude is, like, you know, that's nice, but, like, you know, champion attitude is nothing without, like, you know, mentors who nurture that attitude.
Mm.
You know, like, you know, without those mentors, man, like Georgie Benton, while I was fighting Georgie Benton, Artie Cintron, George Washington, they were my mentors as a boxer, right? Without them, like, you know, I'm not winning, like, 5 national championships or 4 Golden Gloves. I'm not.
Mm.
As an actor, I have, like, you know, people like Ron Shelton, Michael Mann. I mean, like, a plethora of, like, other people who support me, like, and push me, right? And mentor me. So when I buck and fall, and I do fall, like, they're a hand, like, you know, hey, get up. You can get up.
So I've got to ask, you've had this amazing journey. Your story's been told to a much larger audience now. What's next? What's going on in life? What do you got going on? What can we expect?
on the hush,
whatever you want to give.
I'm in talks to develop a TV show in the world of boxing, amateur boxing, and that's what I can say at the moment.
All right, cool, very cool. Now, I would like to, just because this channel is mainly for boxing, do you keep up with boxing? Are you super in tune to what's going on today with boxing?
It's in my DNA.
Okay.
Whether I want to or not, I do.
So let me pick your boxing brain for a while. Yeah. Let's talk about the heavyweight division for a moment. Deontay Wilder, Anthony Joshua, Big Baby Miller, Tyson Fury, the list goes on. Is this the new golden era of heavyweights? Have athletes gotten better? I mean, these guys are humongous. They're bigger, definitely. Are they better, though, in your opinion?
Did you hear what you just asked me, bro?
Yeah.
He asked me, is this the golden era of what?
The new golden era. Because the last golden era was yours with Tyson, Lennox Lewis, Holyfield. And then before that, the 70s with Muhammad Ali.
If a golden era is, what does that mean? That means like it's special, right? It's like,
yeah, it's absolutely. Right? Okay, so there can't be multiple. Right. Okay. So is this a comparable era? Is it at least enlightening, because for a while now, for a while there was a decade where the Klitschko's dominated, right? And that was considered a very boring time for the heavyweight division. In your eyes, as a fan, is the heavyweight division exciting?
Oh, sure. It's very exciting. Yeah.
Do you have a favorite? Is there a horse in the race? Is there anyone you like?
I admire Anthony Joshua, and I admire, what's the brother that Mark Breland trains? Wow, I should know this kid.
Deontay Wilder.
Wow.
Yeah.
Sorry, Deontay. Brain fart, man. But I admire Deontay Wilder.
Yeah.
So,
do you have a pick between those guys? Who wins that matchup? That's a super fight.
I admire Deontay Wilder and I admire Anthony Joshua.
Okay.
That's all I'm going to say, bro.
All right. Sounds good. Let me just give you some more matchups real quick.
What's your chops, man?
Errol Spence.
Right.
Terrence Crawford. This is the super fight at welterweight. At 147, that's the one everyone is asking for. How do you feel about that?
I was just talking with my dear friend Thomas Hauser.
Yeah.
And we were debating that fight. He says it's a pick'em. Technically, I'm leaning towards 146.4. Spence.
Okay, yes.
Yeah, I just like it. I just see more.
I thought when you said technically, it was going towards Crawford, because people consider him the more technical boxer.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Crawford, I think, is a more, Spence.
Okay.
He's more technical fighter, man. And I think he's, his radar and his all-around sense of where he is in the ring.
Okay.
Ring geography, that counts for something, man. Where you can step over here and know where you are with your eyes closed, that counts for something. And Errol has that. That's not a natural gift. He earned that.
Mm.
That's taught.
Wow.
That's taught.
Well, thank you, champ. I appreciate your time and being so generous with it. It was an honor to get that interview. Thank you so much.
Yes, sir.